taking in some rest and recreation in our R&R show. Lounging poolside with me are the really relaxed Susan Kalman. The radiantly refreshed Lou Sanders. The rigorously revitalised Stephen K. Amos. The reasonably rat-arsed Alan Davis. Now, don't forget to be mindful of your buzzers. Susan goes...
You are an island, a desert island. Feel your troubles lapping away from your feet.
I need to wee now. Lou goes...
Listen to the sound of my voice as you experience deep relaxation.
Where is that person from? I mean, Stephen goes.
Let your worries melt away and find your happy place.
Recorded, didn't you?
I'll be really honest, I don't think I got a speech in. Let your worries melt away. You'll be all right, love, all right?
Leading to death in an alleyway.
I love the idea of you as a relaxation app. I think that's...
I'll just get on with it, for God's sake!
And Alan goes...
You are feeling sleepy.
Now?
Yeah.
Yeah, excellent. Anybody favourite ways to relax?
I like meditation to relax. I don't do it now because I'm already enlightened, but I used to do it a lot.
Okay.
Yeah, because I fell asleep a lot, but it was kind of meditation. And then...
So that is just sleeping, you know that, right? Okay.
And I woke up once from a meditation and honestly, I thought I could speak Portuguese. I was so sure that I could. And then I thought, oh, no, I don't even know the word for yes.
What about you, Alan? You like to go to football, don't you?
Yes, but I don't get relaxed at football.
No.
If I want to have a nap, I'd go for a drive.
Okay.
I've slept for 50 miles on the M1.
What about you, Susan? Are you a relaxer?
Smoking jacket, pipe, mantelpiece, globe that turns into a bar, a light reading aloud of Miss Marple of an evening. Just a very traditional ladies' evening. Okay. And then a hand of bridge. Probably. Yeah. So no. Just that kind of some brandy.
Something. I know you. You count your Smurf collection.
I do count my Smurf.
Is it more relaxing to be in a locked room or an unlocked room?
What?
I think it's more relaxing for other people if you're in a locked room.
That's interesting, you see, because some people think the door's locked, I'm fine.
Mm.
And other people think the door's locked, I can't get out.
Have you ever done that thing of staying in a hotel and you wake up and you can't remember where the toilet is and you're naked and so you open the wrong door? Anyway, I was in the corridor and the door closed.
Can't you just get under it?
Okay. Those are all good, but we have some ideas of our own about relaxation. So, Alan, I know the absolute perfect thing to make you relax. Unfortunately, it was too big to fit under the desk. Bring on the cow! So, how might this cow aid relaxation? What do you reckon?
Sit underneath it and get a pat on the head.
So here's the thing, you can cuddle a live cow in a farm in upstate New York, and weirdly called Mountain Horse Farm, but it's for cows. You pay $75 an hour and you can go and cuddle a cow. Do you want to give it a go, Alan?
That is a lot of money to cuddle a cow.
$75 an hour.
That's a lot of money.
I know, but they assure you, and I don't know why they need to assure you, that the cuddling sessions are private.
Oh, right, well, good.
Yeah.
Good.
better?
I do. I feel much better.
Yeah. Maybe that's all you need. You need some bloke in a flat cap.
I'm not a big fan of the cow. I'll tell you.
Why?
Yeah. Because any creature that's got an eye there and there, yeah, and looks there.
That's upset.
The devil's work.
But if you look at the picture, I mean, it looks sweet, don't you think?
But what is like... that cow actually doing?
Well, we'll find out when it inhales.
Susan, what have you got under your desk for relaxation? Is there nothing there?
Is it this?
What is it? What have you got?
Stephen's leg.
It's not my leg.
This? Yes.
Oh. I'll be honest, Stephen, that wouldn't relax me.
What do you reckon? How would you relax with those?
Genuinely? Dolly Parton. Working not too fast.
I don't know what I would do. Okay, so this is a thing that you can pay money for as well. You would sniff it. It doesn't have to be an orange, it could be a lemon, or I particularly like a lime. Smell it for a few minutes, and it's shown to reduce stress and anxiety. So it's a very expensive clinic in the United States. The Mayo Clinic, they use this as part of their aromatherapy. Do you feel... Do you feel a sense of the relaxation?
No.
No.
I think it depends on where the orange has been.
Mm.
Because...
Stephen!
Lou, what have you got to relax with?
Uh-oh, it's rude.
It's rude? Why do you say it's rude?
Well, straight away, my mind's whirring.
OK.
And I'm going to be polite on this one because my mum didn't like last time when I was...
Did she think you were a bit rude?
Can you switch it on? Has it got an on-off switch?
What is wrong with you?
Yeah.
It's just out there.
It might light up.
No, it's another way of relaxing. So you could either use your own hand or you could use a... Yes.
Oh.
I'm afraid...
Make your mother proud, girl. Make your mother proud.
I'm doing this for Daddy.
What I want you to do, and this is a method of relaxation, I want you to put the thumb into your mouth. It's absolutely...
Oh! You see, I was...
You were
psychic.
Close. Yeah. Close your lips around it.
Yeah.
And then I need you to blow...
Oh!
..like this. And then exhale.
Is it like a bagpipe?
OK, so... So what it does is it... This is a genuine thing to help you relax. It stimulates the vagus nerve. So that's the bit that's responsible for the body's relaxation response. And it is called the Valsalva manoeuvre. And what it does is it lowers the heart rate and it calms you down.
I love it.
Yeah. Right, Stephen, what have you got, my darling?
I have with me a concoction.
Yes.
Which is made up of PVA glue.
Yep.
And bicarb of soda.
Okay.
And I will add to that a little contact lens solution.
Okay, because it takes a while to mix in, we've already put the bicarbonate of soda and the white glue together. Yeah. Add the contact lens solution. We're going to make some slime. Why might you make slime?
Kids love it, man.
They do love it.
It's the feeling of it.
Okay, so this is a slightly worrying thing about the world. 2017 was a huge year for slime. How to make slime was the most popular how-to Google search in the whole of the UK that year.
Wow.
It was huge in the United States. It caused a glue shortage in the US. And people watched people playing with it as a relaxation tool. It's this thing called ASMR, Autonomous Sensory Meridian Response. So you get a sort of tingling relaxation feeling, and apparently you get it with slime.
I like watching the ASMR videos. I like watching people touching things. I think it's really nice.
Well, you're absolutely right. Apparently people like the predictable way in which things move. They like the fact that it's being manipulated. And we are... What colour have you got there?
It started off... It started off as quite, you know, alien-esque, scary green,
yeah,
and now it's kind of snotty.
Yeah, but can you play with it with your hands?
Can I play with it?
Yeah. Well, so the idea is to watch you... watching you play... Maybe the spoon in it is not helpful.
Play with it like they do in the videos, like you're enjoying
well,
it.
I've seen those videos. Okay. I've got a life to lead.
Susan, can you show us?
Yes, of course I can. So what you do is you have to kind of... You go...
Yes, it is that. It's just weird.
The point of these videos is to display the enjoyment of the thing to the person, as if you're showing a prized child.
Do you watch these things on YouTube?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so there's a woman, she's 26 years old, she's called Karina Garcia. She has 9 million subscribers.
Yep.
Watching her play with slime, she makes about $200,000 a month playing with slime. She also does things where she sees how many chicken nuggets she can get in her mouth. And, I mean, it's not for me.
How many can she get in her mouth?
It's a substantial number.
I could get 15.
Oh, I... I so wish we had chicken nuggets right now. Shall we rustle the cow out of here? And many thanks to our farmer.
Well done, farmer.
Wild cow enthusiasm. Who needs Valium when you've got citrus fruit and slime? What's rotund and makes a royal wretch?
Something sort of chubby or round that's a bit smelly and lives in Buckingham Palace?
No, so it's an actual place called a rotunda. I'm going to help you out here. It was in Leicester Square. It is, in fact, still in Leicester Square. Have anybody of you played the Leicester Square Theatre?
I have, yes.
Okay, so this is right next door, and it's still there, and you probably wouldn't even know it. So it was a purpose-built building, enormous building, to display enormous paintings. So the largest paintings of all time, gargantuan panoramas. It was an artist called Robert Barker. He, in fact, coined the term panorama. There he is. And he began with a view of London, and he charged 3 shillings for you to come in, and he made an absolute fortune. And it was an amazing building. So it was perfectly round. It had a lower and an upper circle so that you could do 2 panoramas exhibited at the same time, one above the other. The paintings were so large that you had to have a map in order to find your way around. It is now the French Catholic Church. You can't see it because they've put a brick front on it. So that's what it looks like now, and you might have just walked past it. It's between Leicester Square Theatre and the Prince Charles Cinema. But if you have a look from the air, so say you looked at Google Maps or something, look at the size of it.
Wow.
Isn't it fantastic? And if you look, there is, you pull out there, that is Leicester Square. Mm-hmm. You can see where it's located, and it's become a sort of hidden treasure in London.
Change it to flats.
Yeah. You wouldn't know it was there, which is amazing. Anyway, just a few days before it opened, so we're talking about 1794, King George III and his wife, Queen Charlotte, they were given a private viewing of a naval scene. It was so realistic and so overwhelming that Queen Charlotte, after she stared out at the painted ocean, she became seasick.
I know how she feels, because I went to the IMAX to watch Gravity with Sandra Bullock.
Right.
And
is this a film, darling? Because that just sounds like a really boring thing to do.
It's a film.
You and Sandra Bullock watching Gravity.
Luke, as a... You can't tell me.
Wow. Sandra! Sandra! Sandra!
I mean, you wouldn't need to go to the IMAX, surely.
Sandra! Sandra!
That the star of Miss Congeniality and Miss Congeniality 2, Armed and Fabulous, could not make me interested by doing that. But it was a film about space. It was just her. She was in her pants and vest. That's irrelevant to the story. She was in Gravity. She was there. I was right up close because I couldn't get seats because I was late in booking. It's huge. It's the size of this entire studio.
Wait, why couldn't you get seats? You know Sandra Bullock. I have not understood this story.
I'm there. I'm sitting. She's right in front of me. It was so realistic that I vomited on myself in the cinema because I felt like I was in space with Sandra Bullock, who's a real person who was not doing that. She was trying to escape.
Queen Charlotte definitely would not have enjoyed the panoramic scenes of another gentleman. They were of the Mississippi Valley, but they were by a man called John Banvard. They were known as moving panoramas. I don't know if you would have liked this.
Nope.
So these were from the 1840s, and instead of just having a thing where you stand and you look at the picture, they were on sort of rollers, and they were cranked around, and they had somebody explaining what the story was or what you were looking at. They were amazing. In fact, they were brought here to Britain to be seen in a private viewing by Queen Victoria. It's early kind of moving pictures. Yeah. But the thing that Charlotte suffered from, this sort of motion sickness by just looking at a picture. You can even get sick looking at optical illusions, so the ones that appear to be moving. There's an amazing professor called Akiyoshi Kitayoka, and he was from a university in Kyoto, and he designs illusions on his websites, and he warns you if you look at them, you actually can be sick even though the picture is not moving. And if you are sick, you should immediately cover one eye with your hand, but don't close your eyes because that could make the attack worse of you feeling.
It's like watching Good Morning Britain.
Let's all take a look at one and see how we feel. So this is called irrigation, and it appears when you are looking at it, a completely static picture, that there are rollers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Hands up in the audience who can see that the sort of thing is moving. It's actually moving. I mean, that is astonishing, isn't it? Even though it's a completely static picture. Have a look at another one. This one, I think, is actually slightly more, I don't know, disturbing is the right word. It's called rotating snakes. There it is.
Oh, no.
Is there a general thing? Who finds that one more disturbing than the previous one?
That's on the level of me looking at pictures of my ex-boyfriend.
Should I be concerned that I'm not getting anything from
nothing at all?
No.
Well, it's very interesting that, on the whole, women can see colour and shape better, so the women on the panel will probably be able to see it slightly better than you.
But the one you're staring at doesn't move, the ones around it
move. It's the ones near it, isn't it? There are lots of things on the internet, Stephen, that will say you can tell how stressed you are by how much you can see it move. It's all nonsense. So you're absolutely fine. I wouldn't give it a thought. But for some people, that would make them feel extremely unwell. You're probably the other end of the spectrum.
Oh.
Now, let's put your bodies to the test. What's the least sportsmanlike thing you can do on a rugby pitch?
What they used to do at school was put deep heat in the jock straps.
Is deep heat a euphemism?
No. It's a product.
It's a product.
That will warm up your genitals to a terrific degree during a scrum.
I don't understand this picture because I don't know anything about rugby. But
they're not playing rugby.
Oh, I see.
Tripping. You're not allowed to trip people up.
You're not allowed to trip people, but this is a truly terrible thing, and I think it doesn't reflect well, frankly, on England. It was 1889. New Zealand's rugby team, they were fairly newly formed. They came over to play against England in a place called Blackheath. And during the game, one of the English players, a man called Andrew Stoddart, he was tackled and his shorts accidentally ripped off. So, very nicely, the Kiwi players surrounded Stoddart to allow him to get back his modesty. Nice. While this was happening, another English player, a man called Frank Evershed, picked up the ball and scored a try. I know, Lou, right? Scored a try, unopposed, which was allowed by the referee, a man called Roland Hill, who also happened to be the secretary of the English Rugby Football Union. Three of the Kiwi players went off in protest. They were so furious. England won the game 7-0, and the Kiwis were later forced to apologise for their players leaving the field.
No.
It's not a good story, is it?
No.
But I have a worse one. So almost 100 years later, so we're talking about 1986, the All Blacks, they endured a crotch-related incident. So there was a guy called Wayne Shelford. He went on to be captain. In one of the first games, he ended up at the bottom of the ruck. He lost four teeth and a French boot ripped open his scrotum. Very low groan there. And left a testicle hanging out. It was sewn together on the sidelines. It played on until way into the second half when he was knocked unconscious. He says he has no memory of the game. What's the least sportsmanlike thing you can
do? I would say that.
That is very unpleasant. The secret to succeeding at rugby is to try and try again.
I like that. Thank you.
That's one of two sporting jokes I've made in 5 years. What were the world's first roller coasters made of?
Sturdy stuff.
Sturdy stuff? Mm-hmm. No, weirdly not actually made of all that sturdy stuff.
Wood.
Wood, some wood, but not entirely made of wood. What else might you use?
Snow.
What is more slippy than snow?
Ice.
Ice, absolutely.
I'm well on the way, guys! I can feel it!
Literally like pleasing a Labrador. So the idea goes all the way back to 15th century Russia. So ice slides or flying mountains were built in several towns, including St. Petersburg. I mean, look, these are amazing. So some of them were 80 foot high. They were on wooden supports and then they were coated with water and they quickly froze to a sort of slick, icy surface. And then they used to use hollowed blocks of ice lined with straw as the car to go down. Catherine the Great actually had one specifically built for herself at the Orenbaum Palace on the Gulf of Finland. And everybody thought these were marvellous. They quickly caught on around the world. They became known as Russian mountains. In fact, in Spain, I think they still call them Montana Russa. They look like huge fun, do you not think?
Nope.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, not for me.
Nope.
I'm too, yeah,
not
I'm scared.
Me.
Don't like the height.
But you're not alone. So the pioneering American roller coaster engineer, a man called Ron Toomer, he designed 93 of the world's roller coasters by the time he died in 2011. He didn't like going on them.
No.
No, he said the very thought of it made him queasy. And this is what he did for a living.
I get that, because I don't really like my comedy.
Not as much as your mother dislikes. No, but you're right to be afraid. So in June 1911, the owner of Boston's Derby Racer roller coaster, he stood up in one of the cars to give a speech about roller coaster safety and fell out. And he died. He died. I know. He died while giving a talk about be careful. Actually, This is one of my favourite stories. Does anybody remember Fabio? Do you remember Fabio?
Oh, yeah.
Sexy Fabio.
Sexy Fabio. There he is, Sexy Fabio.
Yeah.
He was often on the sort of cover of romance novels. Anyway, he went on a roller coaster. It was the inaugural ride of this roller coaster in
this.
Virginia. This was in 1999. Yes. And he killed a goose with his face.
When you do that, it's sexy.
Yeah.
Geese like roller coasters?
No, the geese. No, it flew into his face.
Here's the thing: is that we're not really sure whether the goose flew into the roller coaster and then hit Fabio.
It was like Fabio. Fabio. He's moving.
Afterwards, he said it was very dangerous to go on roller coasters. This was clearly not a freak accident, and it would happen again. As far as we know, it hasn't.
This is going to happen again. It's a ticking time.
But I reckon if the bird did fly in his face at that speed, you'd have had much more serious damage than that.
It was probably pulling up, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Imagine it was right on the belly.
Yeah. If it was the soft behind of a goose, then perhaps that would happen.
You mean he was pursuing the goose?
He was pursuing.
Go, Fabio! Go! And then it just went up a loop and went right round.
How I wish you two had been the detectives on this case.
I'm coming for you! Watch me get this goose with my nose. So watch it. This could happen again.
Now it's time for the not at all restful bit we call general ignorance. We're going to speed through this. Fingers on buzzers, please. How do car thieves start cars?
Happy, please.
Hot wire.
Hot wire. It's impossible to hotwire a modern car. Did you know that?
Listen.
Yes, Lou.
It's something to do with the wing mirror, and something in the wing mirror then triggers something else. Look it up. In certain cars.
Yeah.
I can't go into it for legal reasons.
No. Well, what it is, since the mid 90s, there've been all sorts of precautions. So there's a little chip in the key.
I love chips.
If the car doesn't detect the chip, then the key isn't there and then it won't start. But there's all sorts of newfangled technology and you can now use things like scanners and to clone radio signals from the keys, and you can, in fact, do it from outside somebody's house. So you could be outside the house with your scanner and the keys are in the house and they're all fast asleep and you can still start the car. Basically, keep your car keys as far away from your front door as possible or in a biscuit tin.
Oh, yeah. Because thieves do not like biscuits.
First car theft ever was committed by a woman. Did you know this?
I love that.
Yes. So her name was Bertha Benz. So married to...
Oh, not the Benz of...
The Benz of Mercedes-Benz.
Mr. Benz.
Carl Benz. He'd invented the very first practical automobile, and she thought he wasn't doing his best to sell it, so she decided that she was going to take it on the very first long-distance journey. It was the 5th of August, 1888, and she took his car, and she drove 90 kilometres from Mannheim to Pforzheim with her two teenage sons, because she thought, whilst doing this, she might as well visit her mother. I love this about her. At one point, she stopped at a cobbler's and asked him to put some leather pieces onto hammer them onto the brakes so that the brakes wouldn't wear out. And in doing so, she invented the modern brake pad. So she's marvellous, isn't she? She was both a thief and an inventor.
Yeah.
Bet she couldn't park it though.
Do you know what? It's such a pleasure to see somebody doing so well on their last time on the show. Now, how was the cat that got the cream?
Ah?
How was the cat that got the cream?
Very well.
Well, yeah, not very well.
Because cats shouldn't have cream and milk.
They are lactose intolerant. So in order to be able to process the milk, they need the enzyme lactase in their digestive system. Obviously, as a kitten, you have lots of it because you get mum's milk, but then the lactase production rate slows down as they get older.
Did you know, Sandy...
What? Probably not.
Human beings made cheese, and I read this in a cheese book... made cheese for 1,000 years before they became lactose tolerant. Isn't that weird? They used to keep cows and make cheese even though they couldn't digest the milk. And then after about 1,000 years of it, they were able to.
Yes.
People get very, very squeamish when you have a nice cup of breast milk in the morning. But it's fine to have it out of a cow's breast. Why? That doesn't make any sense, does it, Lou?
No.
Well, the thing is, you don't gain anything nutritionally from having that kind of milk, not even breast milk.
But it is yummy.
Okay. adult cats are lactose intolerant. So let's look at the final results in last place. Well, this is extraordinary. This has never happened before. We have a triple placement of people in last place with -6. And this will give away who's the winner. With -6, we have Stephen, Alan, and Lou. And Stephen, Lou and Alan, and I leave you with an old American story about the risks of combining work with recreation. As she lay there dozing next to me, one voice kept saying, "Relax, you're not the first doctor to sleep with one of his patients," but another kept reminding me, "Howard, you're a veterinarian." We'll be right back.